Okay, it looks like our numbers are starting to level off, so we'll let people keep joining the webinar as we get started, but we'll go ahead and get going this morning. So hello and good morning or evening, everyone. Thank you so much for attending this DCO webinar. For those of you who don't know us, my name is Marissa McCassin, and I'm a program associate at the Center for Effective Global Action, CEGA, a research center at UC Berkeley. My colleague, Leah Bridle, and I work on a research initiative called the Digital Credit Observatory, which we call the DCO. The DCO was established in 2016 with support from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation to support a coordinated portfolio of research on the impacts, both positive and negative, of digital credit products in emerging markets. Since 2016, we've funded 16 independent studies in over 10 countries. As many of these studies finalize results in the coming year, we plan to host a series of DCO webinars sharing what they have learned and hope that you will subscribe to our newsletter for future invitations. Today, we are especially excited to host our second DCO webinar, the first to share results from a DCO-funded study. Jonathan Robinson, one of our DCO scientific directors, together with Pascaline Dupas and Valentina Brailovskaya, will share preliminary results from their work on the impacts of digital credit in Malawi. Now, just a little bit about how we're going to run the call. We ask that you use the question and answer function for questions. The research team will answer clarifying questions via the Q&A during the presentation, and then the DCO team will organize and pose more discussion-based questions after the researchers have finished sharing results. The chat will be disabled, but the Q&A will be open and you'll have the ability to upvote questions. We hope you stay engaged throughout the presentation. So without further ado, I turn it over to John.
Thank you very much, Marissa. Do I sound okay? Great. Thanks. Thanks very much for the opportunity to present. We're very excited to present this work. It's the first time we're presenting these results, which is based on a field experiment in Malawi with an MNO there. So without further ado. So the reason why we're studying this topic is that widespread adoption of mobile phones and associated mobile money products has recently made it possible for telco companies to provide digital credit. So in the typical digital credit offering, an MNO partners with some financial institution to provide a loan on their existing mobile money network. And this is exciting to a lot of people because it enables credit scoring based on mobile money transactions, non-traditional data compared to what a bank or an MFI would typically do. As currently offered, these loans tend to be very short term and for small amounts of money. So looking across the different products in various contexts, the loans are often due in several weeks or a month, and annualized interest rates end up being well over 100% per year. So digital credit is, in many ways, a revolutionary change, potentially, in access to credit for individuals. So as has been coined by Chen and Mazur, digital credit is instant, automated, and remote, meaning that loans can be approved immediately without the intermediation of a loan officer. Their scoring is done on by algorithm by a computer, and this can be done without traveling to a physical location to access funds. So this also has just enormous scale, just because already there's at least tens of millions of people that have gotten digital credit loans, mostly in East Africa. But just given cell phone plan penetration rates, this could extend to hundreds of millions of people. The question we're trying to ask here, and what the DCO in general, one of the main priorities of the DCO, is to study what is the effect of this new technology. So many of the things that we look at as benefits of this new technology, for example, how quickly you can get loans, or how simple it could be to just press a few buttons on a phone. Many economists might think that this is going to be a positive thing in the sense that it reduces transaction costs dramatically. And if people are using them, as we see that they are, then revealed preference would suggest that they are benefiting from them in some way. But there's also a widespread notion that consumers are not fully informed about the terms of these loans, and indeed we'll find we'll find some evidence in favor of that. So the terms and the fees are hard to find for the average borrower. On top of that, many people are using feature phones that make it hard to browse the internet. But just physically trying to get information on the loan while you actually apply for it is very difficult. So it's possible that consumers are making mistakes and need their take up of these loans for that reason. So we work with, in this study, we try to shed light on this with a study in, you know, it's one specific study with one particular partner in Malawi. The product we study is going to be very similar to other research in this area, such as Mshwari in Kenya, though the interest rate, hesitate to call it an interest rate, but a facilitation fee that's charged by the MNO is even higher than Mshwari. It's a 10% fee due in 2 weeks with late fees accruing thereafter. And we have two main questions we are going to try to shed light on today, which is, first of all, what is the impact of getting access to digital credit? And to answer that, we use an approach similar to a number of other studies in microcredit and also the recent study of Mshwari, which is doing a regression discontinuity design around credit scoring thresholds. We were able to work, though we did not collaborate directly with the credit scoring partner or with credit scoring partner's key individual. They did share with us data that makes it helpful to do this, including the credit score itself. On top of that, we were in communication with them just as the product was relaunched, and so we're able to look at impacts immediately after this product became available. And then second, we have a concurrent, though I'll present them sequentially here, the concurrent RCT, which was focused specifically on the possibility that consumers are making mistakes based on the fact that they're not fully informed about the fees. So we did a financial literacy intervention using IVR methodology, interactive voice response, which I'll talk about later, but which informed consumers about the costs of borrowing from this product. We have impacts on both of these using both the mobile money data that the telco has provided and surveys. And then finally, we're interested in looking at how effects differ by gender. So primarily what I'll do today is present most results by separately by gender. And the reason for this is that in general, there's a gap between men and women in terms of access to finance that has been studied and discussed extensively. Including in the Findex, for example, that's where that number comes from. And so there's some hope that digital financial services might possibly bridge this gap, though, as has been documented, men and women are differentially likely to own a cell phone. But nevertheless, the reduction in transaction costs seems like in principle could lead to higher levels of financial inclusion for women specifically. In Malawi, in our context, there's a very large gender gap where about 60% of the consumers from this telco are men. And even conditional on having an account or using an account, women use it less. So it's an interesting context to look at this, and we'll show results separately for men and women. We designed the experiment such that we could, we oversampled women so that we could do this in a statistically powered way. So with that, just in the interest of time, I don't really have a literature review, but and instead we'll opt to get directly into the research. And so I'll first, the way I'll talk today is just, first of all, just lay out the context because I think it's very important, then talk about our two designs and then conclude. So the project that we are running is with the telco company Airtel, which is the bigger of two large telcos in Malawi. They have about a little bit over 4 million subscribers in a country of less than 20 million people. So the history of digital credit in Malawi, compared to people that are familiar with it in East Africa, is that Malawi is definitely behind some of those other countries. So the first digital credit product was offered only in 2016, and this is with only a limited number of borrowers, about 30,000. And for various reasons, this was put on hiatus in 2018, the main being that there's a liquidity problem for the funder, which we'll come back to later, but default is definitely not uncommon on this product and on others. And so I think about the high interest rates, that's certainly going to be one reason for that. But in any case, it suggests that the telco wasn't necessarily making huge profits off of this, at least initially. The product was, for our purposes of what we're doing here, is that the key details is that the product was relaunched in the summer of 2019. There was a rescoring that happened then using data in principle could have included a long history of mobile money usage. It seems we have a lot of the data that went into that decision, and it seemed to be based mostly on mobile money transaction data over the past several months. And this was just rolled out initially to only 27,000 borrowers, which is what the sample for this study is going to be. Also have noticed that the MNO wallet didn't have digital credit for cash mobile money credit. There had been a product, and there continues to be a product called Kutapa, which is digital airtime loans, and those are extremely popular, as we'll see in the results. I skipped over that the name of this product will come out through the talk, is called Kuchova. Okay. So the terms, which I briefly already mentioned, are that there's a 10% facilitation fee that's due in 14 days. So if this is not repaid after 14 days, the interest rate does not directly compound, but there are late fees that are assessed afterwards. And those late fees are 2.5% of the cost of the loan and are meant to be charged up to 3 times. So on an annualized basis, this is an extremely expensive credit. On the other hand, clearly these sorts of loans seem like they would make the most sense for emergencies or very high liquidity needs, in which case, it's harder to say. As I'll talk about, the credit in general in Malawi is expensive. To be eligible, borrowers have to have had an account for 6 months. That's for several reasons, but one of them being that if a borrower were to default on a loan, there's a limited recourse of the lender to punish the borrower. And so one major way might be to deny future credit on that SIM card, but people could always switch their SIM card. So this is one way of at least enforcing that default will have some effect on the availability of digital credit anyway. Okay, this table is showing us what our survey data looks like. The first line at the top is what we can see from the Know Your Customer data that exists in Malawi. There's very limited information on that, but we do know that the gender breakdown, which as I said, is heavily towards men. In Malawi is a country that has two major population centers, the Longwe and Blantyre, and one third of the sample lives in those two cities. So when we look at our sample, which is not, oversampled women, and we can reconstruct a population estimates using sampling weights, we can just see a couple of stats from the survey that we did later, which shows certainly that this population is very positively selected relative to the average person in Malawi. Average years of education is close to 12 in a country where the average nationwide might be in primary school years. 95% of people have an iron roof. Typical monthly income is, $200. So this is a sample of people, as is probably no surprise, that are not, certainly not representative of the bottom of the pyramid in Malawi. Okay. What I'm going to do to start is just give you a sense of what does this product look like? What do people use the loan for? How big are the loans? Those sorts of things. So this first table is looking at characteristics of the loans, how big they were, whether they were repaid, and so forth. And so as I mentioned, that the average loan amount is only a few dollars, $4 US. So there are, as with other products, there is meant to be a possibility here that people can qualify for higher loan amounts as they establish a better credit history. And indeed, there there is differences in the specific amount that people were eligible for, but the amounts tend to be small. It's rare to be borrowing more than $10 or $20 at this point off of this product. We see that overall, only 85% of the loans were fully repaid, which is directly going to link to the interest rate and why it's so high. We also see this this result that many people kind of surprisingly don't pay the loan back on time. Many of them, the difference between this 85% number and the 22% number is that over 60% of people are paying the loan back but late, and so they're paying some of those late fees on the loans as well. So that could be an indicator, perhaps, that people are not fully informed, or could simply be that people face liquidity issues trying to repay this loan. So while every loan is small, once you repay the loan, you can take other ones. And so looking at people who have taken up the loan, the average number of loans they've taken is between 4 and 5, and the total value of the loans is a little bit less than $20. So this is not a huge amount of money, of course, but for these loans of a few dollars, while they don't seem like a big amount of money, could be helpful for expenses that come up from day to day or week to week. Okay, so we look at what was the purpose of these loans, and broken down by the top panel is for consumption needs, the middle panel is for business needs, and the bottom is for coping with emergencies. So a lot of people are taking out loans for airtime. 29% of the loans are for airtime. But also 21% are for food, 11% are for electricity, 4% for transportation, for the own transportation uses from the business panel in the middle, another 10 or 11% are for transportation expenses, business equipment, and so forth. So, it's hard to summarize this quick snapshot, but some of these expenses certainly seem non-frivolous. If we focus on food, for example, if a fifth of the loans are for that, that paints this maybe in a slightly different context than others, at least for those individuals, compared to ones in which loans are being taken out for gambling or for a night out or what have you. Of course, these are self-reported answers on a survey, so we can take them with a grain of salt, but many of the reasons seem to be consistent with them being used for short-term liquidity needs, though we can come back to that. So the final piece of background context is just to give you a sense of what other options do people have in Malawi. And so I think one of the key reasons why this digital credit product looks like it might, why the rates might be subpar is that we might have the notion that there are other ways that people can borrow money without such high rates, but it seems like that's not really the case. So when we look at digital airtime loans in column one, which are, just those Kutapa loans, which are used entirely for airtime, it's just interesting that 55% of people have taken out that loan over the time period of our survey, over the 3 months prior to the survey. 25% of people have taken loans from friends and family, and these are for much larger amounts on average. So those, if you need to access larger amounts of money, things like family and friends, VSLAs, which are savings groups in Malawi, MFIs, and so forth, can help you access higher amounts of money. But the interest rates are high. So if you look at column three, and I realize it's flipping through these too quickly to process, but if you look at column three at the bottom where we said have the interest or fee in percentage points, the fee, the interest rate on VSLA loans is 24% and the term is 2 months. So while that may work out to be slightly less than what the what Kuchova is offering, these interest rates are still quite high. So MFIs and banks have slightly lower rates, but also only 4% of people have taken out a loan from those. And then finally, from column six, it is the case that people take money from money lenders in response to this is when they badly need a larger amount of money. The interest rates on these loans are, the average is 35% over a 2-month period. So it's rare that people take these, but not unheard of. So just in general, the credit context is one in which credit is very expensive for people. The one way that they can get money slightly cheaper is from friends and family, though some of those have high interest rates as well. But there's only so many times you can do that. Okay, so with this, so the punchline so far is that is just to say that this is a context in which access to credit is limited, and it provides some sense of what is Kachova doing when you, given this context. You might, it may not look as if the rate is so out of line with what people are getting in the first place. Okay, so now let me talk about the regression discontinuity work we're going to do. So, just given that there's such a limited amount of time, I can just give you a flavor of what we've done and be happy to follow up more with any specific questions. So in general, we perform a completely standard regression discontinuity using the fact that we have, that we were working with the credit scoring partner at the right time. So when Kuchova was launched again in July 2019, we were in contact with them before then. And though we did not work directly with them on the scoring or know anything about the algorithm, we do know, or we think we know, many of the variables that went into the scoring decision. And the scorer was kind enough to provide the score itself, which will allow us to look at people above and below the threshold. And so we run a local linear regression using standard techniques in which we will control for a linear function of the credit score through the threshold, and then conditional on that, look at any additional effect of crossing the threshold on access to credit. We'll then go on to look at several impacts, which I can talk about as we get into it. Okay, so the data we have to do this is we have administrative data from the MNO, and that's going to be used for many of the results about take-up. But for questions like what are impacts or what is the effect on other sources of credit, we use a phone survey. So we were pretty happy about how this went. So we were just calling numbers that were given to us from the MNO. We had no other information on them whatsoever, and so just implemented a large calling protocol. We're very grateful to our partners at IPA for their work on this and the rest of the project. And so we just called individuals and attempted to call them a large number of times. Eventually many people did pick up the phone and did do the survey. So there was a small amount of compensation, less than $1, that I think nevertheless did help. The survey took about 30 minutes, and so compared to other projects that we may have done in the past with in-person surveys that could last a huge amount of time, we just have a little bit of information on people's background characteristics, much of which we've already seen. And then otherwise, we mostly just have the surveys really laser focused on credit and other financial access variables. Okay. And then for impacts, we're going to have a few measures of financial security or self-reported financial health or ability to cope with shocks and things like that. Okay, so to start, we have questions about, or we can document whether people above the credit threshold borrowed relative to those below the credit threshold. So this is like a first stage of a regression where we're looking at, as is the case in many of the tables we'll have in columns 1 and 2, are the full sample, and then we break it down by men and by women. And so this regression is based on people who are in our survey, and we have a clear effect on applying to this loan, as we would expect, given that we have such close information on what exactly the credit scores were. So at the bottom, we have the mean, the probability of getting Kuchova at the for the non-eligible, and that's pretty much zero, as you'd expect. And then we have a jump up from that in the full sample from no access whatsoever to about 40% of people are taking out loans. And so just as a starting point, you know, just the fact that we have 40% of people taking out loans within a few months of the surveys and self-indicative that there's a lot of demand for this product. So certainly if you were to talk to the MNO, many customers want this product, are eager to get it. And that's consistent with this. So when they offer the product, many people take it up immediately. This is just in a figure form looking at something similar. And this is just showing that for scores below the threshold, there's really no access. But then when we get above the threshold, there's clear jump up, which is what we're using for the analysis that follows. Okay. So the questions we seek to answer in the regression discount annuity part of the work is, first of all, what is the effect of getting access to Kachova on other sources of credit? And second, what is the impacts of access to Kachova? So in terms of other forms of credit, this table shows in column one access, just for reference, access to Kachova. And then the other columns are showing other sources of credit, which, as I noted before, are more rare, at least in frequency. So digital airtime loans, family and friends, savings groups combined, those are VSLAs and ROSCAs, and formal loans from MFIs and banks. So on the whole, we don't really see a big change in other sources of credit, though you may notice that there does seem to be something going on with VSLA or ROSCA credit, that there seems to be a decline in this. The effect sizes on this, so the dependent variable on this is credit in US dollars, as reported in the survey. And so the amount is the amount for the Kachova loans is only 30 cents, you know, which might be a dollar or so based on the fact that that only 40% took it up. The effect on VSLA or ROSCA credit seems very large compared to that. So we don't want to make too much of it. Certainly going into this, we would have thought that it's possible that VSLA credit could have been crowded out in favor of this, but you know, that remains to be explored. On the whole, however, there for other sources of credit, there doesn't seem to be a major change. You could look at this is just one more form of credit, and it doesn't really change anything else. And so with that, we can also look at whether there were any impacts on other outcomes. And so I think that though it's hard to tell what people's reactions are sitting alone in a room, but I would think that people might be skeptical that a loan of such a small amount could really have a huge effect on people's lives. And we do take that very seriously. On the other hand, it's certainly possible that getting a loan for food during a very bad period could be highly beneficial at that time. So rather than just offer my opinion, we have a few measures of financial security, and I should mention that this is very preliminary and there's other outcomes that we have in the survey that we can work on, but we haven't fully done those yet. But we have a few measures here. One is whether people, just a question of whether people are satisfied with their financial well-being. A second question is about vulnerability to future emergencies. And then we have a number of questions about whether people had difficulty paying different types of expenses. So of these three measures, one of them is significant, which you can take it for what it's worth, but we've certainly been intrigued to see that there may be some evidence here that self-reported satisfaction is actually higher from this loan. We don't really see any negative effects here. You know, I haven't had time to exhaustively explore negative effects in this talk, but on the whole, the effects seem to be positive, what we can find. Another interesting thing is that the effect there is bigger for men, for women than for men, which if it turns, you know, if that holds up with more serious analysis, I think would be something we'd be very interested in seeing. Okay, but we, you know, for what it's worth, the effects seem to be positive at least, and we don't see anything negative here yet. So something that, you know, Pascaline and I have done, and others in a lot of projects, is sometimes also just directly asking people some questions after the end of a survey can be helpful. And so we just ask some questions that you can, you know, some people like these sorts of questions, others feel like they might be leading or people might try to answer what you want. But we ask people just directly, you know, have you ever regretted taking out a Kachova loan? You know, if so, why? Do you like the Kachova loan? And just in general, you know, the vast majority of people say that they didn't regret it, they like it. you know, there could be something interesting there about looking at the 10% of people who did regret it. Maybe those people ended up wasting it on something that was harmful to them. But on the whole, the people's level of satisfaction with the loan seems quite high. So on the other hand, though, when we ask people about like the, what they know about the terms of the loans, it's very vague. So I think a lot of people do not know the specific amounts or due dates. Very few people know exactly what the late fee is. So that would be consistent with the idea that a lot of people are paying them back late. My impression is that people have a vague sense of what this is and they're not too far off, but it could certainly be the case that that they're misinformed about what they're taking out. And then finally, in the last panel, which shouldn't be panel B, but C, which is just to ask them, what do people do if they were, especially during the liquidity issue where they didn't have enough money to give out for their loans, it would be common for people to apply for a loan and not get it. And so we asked them, if that ever happened to you, what did you do? And some people say that they borrowed from somewhere else, others that they took money from their own savings, but a lot of people just wouldn't have incurred the expense at all. So a lot of it comes down to whether that expense was something that was a necessity or something that was important or whether it wasn't, because a lot of times that that expense is just not being made. So if that's a meal that skipped, that would clearly be a negative outcome. If it were something more discretionary, maybe it would be less so. So I've already summarized. That's with the 10 minutes I have left. Let me talk about the financial literacy RCT, okay? So the RD, I would say, I should caution that these results are extremely preliminary and need a lot more work. We seem to be showing some positive effects, but also certainly that consumers are not fully concerned, fully informed, I'm sorry. And there are a number of questions or concerns about digital credit. I would say, in my opinion, that's definitely one of the major ones, is that consumers are not fully informed about the decisions that they're making. So we addressed this one possible problem with a randomized controlled trial that was implemented concurrently with the work I've already presented. So consumers were called and asked to participate in an IVR module, financial literacy module. And so they were enrolled in this by being called through an automatic calling program. And then if they stayed on the line, would start this survey. They also received a number of text messages and were, in general, tried to contact them a number of times in various different ways. There are four treatments that we have. It's a very straightforward RCT, but nevertheless, there are a few twists that are nice. One is the main intervention is the financial literacy module, which I'll talk about. A second is a module that still asked people to call in, but didn't have as much detail about information. And then some that are much lighter touch. So the financial literacy module, we were very mindful of time on this, and so we developed a short module, which was still 15 minutes. And it was based on an anecdote of a store owner, and the example was that she was borrowing money for inventory and she was considering using Kachova or other sources. And so it's done in the form of a quiz with questions that are answered by respondents. So she's deciding whether to take this loan or another loan, and we'll be happy to share this module when we have all our materials ready. But it discusses the fact that if she were to take a Kachova loan, the interest would be 10% over 2 weeks. It talks about the late fees. And then it also tries to have a discussion about what is the cost of this relative to her other options. So the module kind of concludes with a discussion of what are some of the key points that are being tried to be made. And they really boil down to that: one, it's important to know what the terms are before you take out the loan. Two is that the cost of any one loan might be small, but as you take more of them, they may add up. And there is a discussion that people should think about whether they could use these loans or savings instead, because that might have some benefits in the longer run. I would say on the whole that when we designed this module, I think we would say that it was meant to be very cautionary and was definitely coming from the perspective that the interest rate would be perceived as very high, and just to make sure that people are aware of it, I would say it's definitely didn't see this as any sort of endorsement of the product, but instead one about perhaps suggesting that people slow down a little bit. People perceived it, however, very differently, it seems. So then people also received text messages that just provided just some basic information on what the interest rate was and the late fees. Okay. The salience module is extremely similar, except that, so people were asked to call into a service, but the quiz itself only took 3 minutes. And the idea is that, and all it talked about was just what the interest rate was, what the fees were. So this has two goals. One is just to, if you think that part of the intervention is just making them think about Kachova, this is meant to control for that. But then I think another reason is that we were concerned that take up would be very low of the IVR. And so this provides a control group in a way that we could look at people who at least called into the service for statistical power that could help. As it turns out, we don't seem to need it as much as we thought, but for that purpose, but it's a nice design feature. And then we have the interventions, whether text messages or nothing. Okay. So briefly, we were, similar to the phone survey, we got a large amount of compliance, in our opinion, compared to what we were expecting. So about 50% of people at least started the module or did some aspect of it. People did get frustrated and hang up at some point. So only 20% completed it. That's still higher than what we expected. But if we take people who started it and people who finished it, we have about half of people did it. And so, for future work, we can look at how effects vary across those two using the salience module. Okay, so this is just showing a take up using that measure of at least calling in and doing some part of it. And so we can see that, that it's, in our opinion, higher than expected, and we seem to have similar response rates for the salience and the IVR. However, we do have higher response rates in this case for men than for women. Okay, so what was the impact of this intervention on knowledge? Okay, so in the last 5 minutes, I can talk about the results here. So this table has a lot of information on it, but is basically about basic information about the loan. So the first column is whether people know what the interest rate or the fee is. Number two is whether they know what the due date is, et cetera, et cetera. So if we look at column one, at the very bottom, we have the mean of the dependent variable. And so that tells us that only 37% of people know what the fee is. And that goes up by 16 percentage points in the financial literacy intervention. The salience also has an effect there, as you might expect it would, and as well as the info SMS. And this is true for all of these measures. So there's clearly people are learning something about the basics of what the interest rate is. And then there's quite in columns 4 through 9, there are questions about what does Airtel do if you don't pay back on time? So in column 4, kind of a slightly worrying number is that 50% of people do not know what happens there. That goes down by a lot in the financial literacy group, and they realize that they're going to pay a late fee, that late fee compounds and so forth and so on. So the level of financial knowledge about this is low, but the intervention has an effect, a clear effect on that. Okay, so then what happens then to loan demand and to repayment? Okay, so because there's limited time, I won't talk about every number here, but this table is broken down into lending that happened very shortly after the intervention and lending that happened longer. So we've broken it down in an ad hoc way between, and also to match the survey, which asked about a 3 month look back period, was looking at the first 3 months or so and then the longer term. But so if we just focus on say the first 3 months, we actually see this is, this is loan take up in Kwacha, not in USD. We can change that in the future, but the FinLit intervention actually increased demand for the loan, which we didn't have a strong feeling about it one way or the other, but I think our prior would have been that it would have decreased demand for the loan, but that's not what happens. And so we see an increase in demand for the loan that's true also in the longer term. And that effect is bigger for women than for men, especially if you look at compared to the base level of borrowing, which is lower. So there's effects on loan demand, but in the direction of increasing loan demand, not decreasing. Okay. So then the question then becomes, are these borrowers bad risks that never should have taken out loans in the first place? And so we're encouraging, you know, maybe people learn that, hey, there's nothing that can really happen if you take out a loan, so why don't you do it? So this this table shows us, I won't get into the gender impact so much, but it's just column one and two, or the even number columns, are whether people fully repaid the loan. The odd number ones are whether they fully repaid the loan, and the even ones are whether they paid back late. And so in terms of full repayment, which the average of that is in column one is only about 90% or 89%, there's no real effect on that, so which could be seen as a positive result in the sense that that people are no riskier than the underlying base already. But then from column two, there's actually some evidence that they don't pay back late as much, maybe being aware of the late fees, which could be good or bad for the lender. But in any case, there's some evidence that people might be a little bit better informed from this intervention. But in any case, they're not riskier borrowers, it doesn't look like, than the rest of the borrowing base. Okay. So, you know, in the interest of time, I won't go through these other results. We do have some results on whether any effects on other outcomes. There's some evidence on that, but won't dwell on that for this talk. So what I will say, though, however, is that if we look at the financial literacy intervention and just go back to the question that we were already asking about whether you ever regretted it, do you like Kuchova, we see again that you know, again, the vast majority of people like it, very few people regret it. And that doesn't seem to be affected by the treatment. If we look at why do people use the Kuchova, which is in columns three through five, you know, people say in column three, almost 70% of people say that's because it's easy. But also another 18% in column four are saying because there's actually a lower interest rate, which is against our baseline expectations. But in any case, there's some evidence there that that the loan is not out of line with what they have access to otherwise. So I'm just about out of time. So let me just wrap up then and just say that our main result is that despite the high fees, we find substantial demand for digital credit. That seems to be very clear, and also just matching the anecdotal experience of high unmet demand for these loans among Airtel subscribers. If the evidence we have so far, while preliminary, suggests that the effects are positive, at least modestly, there's no evidence of negative effects so far. On the other hand, we definitely find that consumers are not fully informed. You could look at this one of two ways. One is that people basically know the details and understand that there's a, you know, when they have to repay and so forth, but don't know the specifics, or that people are pretty uninformed about it. But we find that doesn't seem to be the reason for demand for the loans, because when we do this in IVR module, which just tells them what this is, it doesn't really affect loan demand and maybe has a slightly positive effect on repayments. And then finally, as mentioned before, Malawi has a large, enormous gender gap in access of mobile money and financial services generally. And we do find a little bit of evidence that effects are bigger for women than for men, at least in percentage terms. So to come back to the title, our results would suggest that this is, that digital credit is filling a hole, not digging one. There's not a huge amount of research on while there's a number of people who are interested in this, many of whom might be on the call, there is not a lot of completed studies of this. I would say our results are roughly similar with prior work on MSHWARI. And lastly, I would just mention that Malawi is a very different context than other places where people might be thinking of digital credit, where maybe there's a number of predatory lenders and you know, much more advanced digital credit ecosystem. In this situation, there's very little, there's nothing available other than the digital airtime loans. And so it's possible that as things get more complicated and as other ways of spending money or wasting digital money occur, that the effects might be more negative. But for now, it seems like the effects are positive. But still, nevertheless, this is just one study. And so we're very interested in what we find here, but we're also looking forward to seeing the other studies that come out of the Digital Credit Observatory over the next year or so, which will add to this evidence base in a much bigger way. So thank you.
Great, thanks so much, John. So we have a couple of open questions. Thanks so much, Pascaline, for monitoring the Q&A platform. I'm happy for you all as co-authors to kind of take over and take these in the order that you think makes the most sense, but I'm seeing some questions about differences between the 2016 program and the one that you were studying in terms of default rates, the KYC data that you had available, as well as some details around understanding specific effects and some questions about research design choices. So how would you like to begin, Pascaline or John?
Just a clarification question. Can people unmute themselves to ask questions, or we have to, with the combo that we have to relay their questions to John?
I think we primarily plan to relay just for logistics purposes, yeah.
Okay, yeah. So I guess John, Josh Blumenstock had a number of questions that I thought would be good to answer live. So one was, as Lia said, whether we have any data on the previous installment of the Kuchoba program, when they launched in 2016, you mentioned that the default rates were much higher. And so why do we think that the default rate in the version that we look at is not as bad? Even though it's still kind of like 15%. And I think, I don't think we actually have much data on the 2016 program, but if you wanna say more.
Yeah, no, that's a great question. Yeah, no, we do have some descriptive data on that program. I think it's actually probably not that different than what we find here. So I think, so my understanding, like this is very specific to the context here, was that it started off with a higher, we actually observed that as well in our data. We didn't have time to get into it, but the default rate seems to be getting worse over time, is what those stats seem to say. And so I think that there was a similar story in the previous iteration of this as well. So I think that the rates were not that different than this, actually. That's right. So whether this is viable or not is a whole other question. So like knowing the other digital credit observatory projects, we know that this is a common thing, that the default rates are relatively high and lenders are hesitant. But I think the same is true here.
Okay. We also had a question that I think Valia would be the best to answer about KYC data and how complete that data was. I would add that maybe, Valia, you could also speak to how accurate the data was, since that's something we can check with our survey, and it was not perfect.
Yeah, so for the most part, the data was complete. I think we had some missing observations for gender. Regarding the accuracy, it was relatively complete. There was a correlation in the gender variable, at least there was a correlation around 0.7 between self-reported gender of the user and what was reported in the KYC. And we don't know if this is necessarily a mistake or miscoding, because it's possible that the phone was registered under a male household member, and then the phone was just given to a female to use, and we actually spoke to the user of that, primary user of the phone. So mainly it's complete, accuracy, somewhat accurate.
Great, thanks, Valia. John, Betty Wilkinson wanted to know if we've computed what the fee corresponds to in terms of the interest rate per month or the APR. And I guess it depends on whether we include the late fees. But you wanna?
Yeah, it's a great question. Like I was actually doing, like, so Vali and I were working on like trying to do that calculation, and it's just so astronomically high that we didn't, like, just having a conversation last night about how don't even put it. But yeah, it's a great question, because the thing is the interest rate does not accrue. So the in terms of how to calculate it, it's confusing. So in terms of like what it actually is, like if we just think of it as a descriptive measure of what that works out to an annualized basis, it's like thousands of percent or something like that. But in some ways it's not really a loan that can be annualized. And so in some sense, the way we chose to present it was just to show the interest rate for the amount of time that the loans are due. But it's a good question. We struggle with how to present that, really.
Yeah, to quickly add to that, some of the loans also don't have term limits. So it's a little bit hard to calculate a monthly equivalent for that.
Um, There was also another question from Josh about our comment, which was about how we interpret the RD, since it's not really a single loan treatment. It's like once you are above the threshold, you can get, you know, repeated loans. And so that's like, how do we want to think about that more generally?
Yeah. Just reading the question. Yeah.
I mean, it's just a comment. Maybe we don't have to say much about it. I guess like the, maybe Josh, what you're trying to get at also, and then we can talk about it offline with you, but it's like, if you're above the threshold, then you know that your behavior and repayment is gonna, may matter for your future credit score and your future ability. And so that may be affecting also your behavior, but we think of it as being part of the, I mean, it's a feature of the product, which is that you may have incentives to do a good job repaying to stay in the eligibility group. So I think you're just thinking of the treatment as just all of that together.
Right, and then on top of which the loans are so small, and these are meant to be frequently used small loans, and so on a one-time basis, the benefit is not huge as much. So maybe that's one of the, because the lender and the Airtel have very limited recourse to enforce repayment in this case, and that might be the main way. So that's right, the repayment incentives might be pretty high in this case.
There was also a question about whether we've been able to look at the impact on savings behavior. This is a question by Diego Ufal.
Yes, hi Diego. That's a great question, and yes, we should have, but we haven't done that yet. But yes, that definitely is a primary outcome that we need to be looking at. It's on the to-do list, but it's a great point.
The amounts that they are borrowing from Kutchova are very, very small, so presumably the effect on savings may be limited.
Yeah, it's very important to discuss the issue about that that's brought up for, you know, in other contexts about over indebtedness and those sorts of questions.
All right. Maybe one technical question following up on the KYC question. Mary Griffin is asking whether, given the differences between the KYC and the survey data, how does that affect credit scoring? And is the credit scoring done by account or user? I'm not sure what the account or user mean, but as far as we know, the credit score does not take into account the KYC data. Am I right on that, Valia?
Yeah, it's just transactional data.
They don't even have it, right? Or they didn't have it?
The credit scoring company did not have the KYC data. That's what.
Yeah, I think the scoring is by SIM card, not by individuals. I don't think they're linked necessarily.
Another question was about the propensity score and how it compares to the credit score in terms of ability to accurately predict default. I don't think we looked at that among eligible folks, whether the default is related to the to their score.
Right.
We can do that.
We can, yeah.
Then the results on the VSLA crowd out, which are kind of implausible, as you discussed, John, raised some questions. Daniel Putman asked whether this could be explained via loan size neglect of some type. I don't know what that means, not loan size neglect. I guess it could be that, maybe what you mean, Daniel, is that the VSLA borrowing, you cannot borrow very, very small amounts. So if you're going to borrow, it has to be a very large amount. And so that's why maybe you only need to borrow $2, but if you're going to do it through the VSLA, you're going to end up borrowing $10 because that's the only thing you can do. And so that could be one mechanism. If that's what you had in mind, Daniel, then I think it's possible. Thank you for this suggestion. And sorry if we misunderstood the question. And then do we have information about different repayment rates for first-time borrowers and subsequent borrowers? Here, I should say that essentially the RD is focused on first-time people were eligible for the first time, right? Maria, can you confirm that I'm right? The RD is only for those who just were deemed eligible for the first time, and for those who were previously borrowed, we don't have a way to do an RD.
No. Yes. I'll double check that, but I'm pretty sure that our transactional data only includes people who were included as a part of this wave. There were new customers to this Kuchova loan.
And we also have a question about whether we looked at how loan defaulters were affected in their future borrowing, especially on their credit scoring. So that we don't have a new wave of credit score. We don't know how the credit scoring companies updating this information. You know, that's something we hope to be able to access to in the future, although I have to say it's been quite difficult to get the first round of credit scoring, so I'm not too hopeful. We should be able to look at subsequent borrowing in the data. I think already we see that those who defaulted in the first loan are much less likely to borrow again, and that's because that's just a mechanical constraint. I guess we are almost out of time, so in the interest of time, I'm just going to add one thing to what John said, which is that all this work was done with IPA Malawi, and we are very grateful to all of the staff who worked with us on this, including Patrick Baxter, and who's now left IPA Malawi, and Patrick Simbewe, as well as Monica Chanval, and many others over the years. So thank you, everybody.
Yeah, and we just want to add thank you again to our presenters. It's really exciting to see the first results kind of on the impacts of digital credit. And like you said, John, we're excited to see what the rest of the portfolio says. And so thank you to the presenters. Thank you for everyone that answered really or asked really detailed questions in the Q&A. And we hope that everyone subscribes to the newsletter so that you can really be up to date on what results are coming out of the DCO and be invited to future webinars. So thank you, everyone. Have a great day.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye-bye.